Welcome to the fuzzy logic in application class. So in today's session we go with the rank ordering method of assigning membership values to the membership functions. So one of the simplest method is going to be rank ordering method. It is also going to be a kind of intuition method which we discussed in the rank ordering in the case of the assigning values to the membership functions. So in rank ordering method, let us imagine that we have some five colors like red, orange, green, yellow, and blue. And a combination of red, orange, okay, yellow, orange, all these are the various combinations can be preferred by the individual users by exercising some methodologies. Say, for example, in rank ordering method, preferences are assigned by a single individual or by a committee or by a polling method or by other methods can be used to assign the membership values to the fuzzy variables. So these are all the various things which we have normally going to get based on all these various consensus. So here, say for example, say by an individual, if people are going to pick like the combination of orange and orange is going to be nil, combination of red, red is going to be nil, combination of yellow, yellow is red. That means all these are going to be zeros which we have got here. Right. So similarly, combination of yellow and red is going to be 475. Combination of green and orange is going to be 423. Like this, we get pairwise pairs of the two relationships on these values, which is normally going to give us the relationship between these two fuzzy sets. Okay. And this particular matrix is going to be the relational matrix between these two. So this is how we normally going to get a value on the fuzzy sets, which is going to be the value of the membership function. So this is what one of the method using which we assign the values to the membership functions, right? So the next method, the last method is going to be the neural networks method. So basically we have artificial neural networks. So therefore, assigning membership values using the artificial neural networks are in fact neural networks for that matter. So the artificial neural networks, what is the artificial network? They are going to be biological inspired networks. So it is totally hypothetical in nature. So artificial neural networks are basically biologically inspired network structures, which are highly hypothetical in nature. So what is the meaning of hypothetical? It is purely imaginary, but we can simply figure out certain methodologies of such hypothetical networks based on the experiences of the various human beings. So already we discussed about this neural network's basic structure, which contains nucleus and which is normally going to have the biological neurons. So connected by all these biological neurons. And in between all these neurons, we're normally going to have synapses, which is going to be a huge memory location. And the nucleus is normally going to be the concentration element, which is normally going to, have a concentrated network connectivity or something like, you know, the master of the networks here, using which we're normally going to transfer the information from one neuron to another neuron using this concentrated area, which is normally going to manage with all the activities of these neurons. And dendritis is going to be one more network element which you're going to have. So using this entire elements in the neural networks, we're normally going to perform the information exchange. So this is such a hypothetical network can be considered here to design the artificial neural network such as this. Now this is going to be the artificial neural network which we can think of, which is going to be called as a artificial neural network. So this is what the model of artificial neurons. Now, so this particular from these neurons, we normally going to get so much of information. So all these inputs coming from the neural network, artificial neural network, is taken and summed up here. And they are going to pass through a particular function. And this function is normally going to give us a value. And this value is simply assigned to the membership function. So this is how we normally going to simply implement the assignment of the values to the membership functions using the neural network concept. Okay, so that means what here? This is something like sigma is nothing but neural network system, and this is from this system you're normally going to get a value, and this is given to a function, and this function is normally going to manipulate the values of these neurons, and it is going to give us a value assigned to the membership functions. And here it is normally what kind of values are normally going to come to the input of the function. It is totally based on the characteristics and features of the neural networks. So what are the characteristics of neural networks which we normally going to have here? So as we spoke earlier, this artificial neural networks are biologically inspired networks. Because why it is called as biologically inspired? Because it is totally a hypothetical network. Our brain is totally a hypothetical network. There is no physical connection. If you open up the brain and see, you never see any physical connections between one neuron to another neuron. These neurons we never see, but it is totally hypothetical in nature. So therefore, we simply called it as going to be like a biologically inspired network, which is hypothetical in nature. So artificial networks are organized in a way that may or may not be related to the anatomy of the brain. So it is not based, may or may not, you can have the same anatomy of a brain as it is here in the neural networks, or you can have another kind of a anatomy followed here. It need not be same because it is totally hypothetical in nature. Therefore, based on the requirement application, we can just incorporate the characteristics of the neural artificial networks in the fuzzy logic. Next, what is going to be one more property of neurons? The neurons in the brain property is going to be one more property. It is going to have called as they learn from the past experiences. So it is our brain always going to store the past experiences, and they just simply learn them, and based on the learnings, they're going to keep the information in the memory as a database. So they learn from the past experiences with the database, whatever knowledge they have previously. And in future, if they come across same kind of situations, then they simply use this past memory to deal with the future problems. That is what called they learn from the past experiences. So that is what one of the features of the artificial neural network of a human brain. Then a neuron was designed to intimate the first order characteristics of a biological neuron. So here, in a very basic level, we consider the neurons are going to be of first order characteristics of biological neuron. It is not, every neuron is going to be of first order characteristics. And they are normally designed to interact, to intimate with other neurons, which are going to be a first order, which are going to exhibit first order characteristics. So first order means what? Only one time differentiation. If you think this first order in terms of differential components, we take up only the d by dx or d by dt of the appropriate variable. That means first order differentiation, first order integrations. So all this is going to be exhibit the first order characteristics at a more primitive level, at a more general level. So it has to really implement first order differential components. Then artificial networks resemble brain in two aspects. One of which is that their knowledge is acquired by the network through a learning process. The human brain is normally acquire knowledge through a learning process. So human brain is going to have inbuilt capability of learning. It can learn from the outside atmosphere. So based on the learnings, the information, the conclusive remarks are stored in the memory. So that means it is normally going to acquire learning by the network of the human brain. So because as discussed earlier just now, so the human brain, the knowledge is acquired by the network through the learning process. So human brain is also going to be a very big network. So network of connectivity between one neuron to another neuron. So let us suppose one neuron is having the knowledge of certain things. So another neuron is also going to know about that due to the network connection, with the knowledge that it is having in the another neuron. So that is how it is normally going to exchange the information between one neuron to another neuron in the communication system. And other is interneuron connects weights known as synaptic weights, which are used to store the knowledge. So other part is going to be that, as I just discussed, one neuron is normally going to connect to the other neuron using the database which is stored here. So this is what I was talking to you. Every human brain is going to have some database which is totally imaginary. There is no physical memory location, just like memory elements in the computer system. We cannot see them physically, but we can imagine that there is a huge memory element inside the human brain. And these neurons are normally going to pick data from the neurons from this database, a very big database. So every nucleus is going to have internal memory locations, temporary memory locations, and it is going to be a permanent memory. So using this permanent memory also, we're normally going to get information. So this information is getting passed by this permanent memory and knowledge of the neurons also. So these two are the last two points that we are simply talking here. So that means the human brain is normally resembles the artificial networks normally resemble the human brain in two aspects. One of which is that their knowledge is acquired by network through learning process. Another is interneuron connects weights known as synaptic weights, which are used to store the knowledge. That means the interneurons are normally been connected based on the central database known as synaptic weights database. That is central database we have. And one more is going to be through the network connectivity. Okay, so these two do the learning process. It is normally going to acquire the knowledge. So these two are the basic important aspects of the human brain in terms of acquiring knowledge. So these are the various characteristics of the human brain, which contains artificial neurons. That means human brain always going to learn from the past experiences, and neurons are designed to intimate. We assume that all the neurons can be of first order characteristics, resemble first order characteristics, and they learn by two methods. One is interneuron connects method, and next one is acquiring by the network through learning process method. So these are the various characteristics of the neural networks. And what are the features it is going to exhibit? It is going to exhibit high computational rates due to massive parallel processing. So human brain is normally going to store knowledge regarding different aspects. So the knowledge regarding every aspect is normally going to follow its own methodology of understandability or reaching to a conclusion as far as that particular concept is concerned. That means the human brain can able to process many methodologies simultaneously. That means it can think simultaneously, many kind of aspects simultaneously, based on many methodologies, many procedures to follow to come to a conclusion based on the different knowledge databases. So therefore, it is totally highly computational in general, because it is normally going to have massive parallel processing. Human brain can do massive parallel processing. That means parallelly human brain can think about many subjects in parallel, and he can give a solution to the problems which are normally going to come across in many problems. Okay, that is what the basic, therefore we can say that the artificial network is going to be highly computational. It is normally going to follow high computational rates. That means the computational rates are going to be, you know, unimaginable rates. It is all the based on individual intelligence, but in general, okay, a human being can able to do parallel processing. That is why the computation rate is going to be more highly. The next one is going to be fault tolerance. That means if one neuron is not really working in the brain, but in the brain, every human being is going to have millions and trillions of neurons. So if other neurons are working, even though one neuron is not working, he can get the work done by other neurons. That means if one neuron is damaged, it doesn't affect the overall performance of the human brain. exactly similar kind of thing is there for the similar kind of thing can be incorporated in the fuzzy logic. So fault tolerance is, therefore we can say the fault tolerance is high. Even though one is not working, but the tolerance level is going to be really more. So this is what something like, you know, fault tolerance is going to be high, as damage to few nodes doesn't really significantly affect the overall performance. So we are experiencing severe COVID virus now. So we can just once again take the same example. So that means our human body is going to fight against the COVID, virus particles inside the body. So that means our body, even though it damages some of the cells in our body, but still we'll be having many other cells which is normally going to fight against the COVID. So therefore, our tolerance is going to be a little bit high. Right. If it is at a smaller level, smaller composition, then our body is normally going to fight. So it is something like human body has been exposed to many other viruses, bacteria, every moment, every day, every second, our entire body has been experiencing, right, huge number of viruses and bacteria. But only thing is, because of our immune system, we are not feeling that virus is attacking us, that particular bacteria is inside our body. Even though we are living with many other infinite number of bacteria and viruses, but still we are surviving. Why? Because our immune system is continuously fighting against all those viruses, because of which we are all living happily. But this COVID virus is totally new to the body. It don't know how to fight against that particular COVID. So this is what the neural knowledge once again going to be there. Previously, the neurons don't know the knowledge, what data it has to pick, what kind of secretions it has to release, what kind of white blood cells, quality of white blood cells it has to release to fight against this COVID virus. It don't know. That is why it is fighting inside the body, and due to which heavy fight is going on in the body between the COVID and the body immune system. So this is what high fault tolerance is going to be high. Okay, so human body is really tolerant for many kind of devices, many kind of diseases. So fault tolerance is high, as damage to few nodes doesn't significantly affect the overall performance of the system. So the next one is, with learning and training feature, the network adapts itself based on the information received by it in the past environment. The number 3 and number 4 is very, very important features which need to be incorporated in the artificial neural networks, especially in the designing of the AI systems, artificial intelligent systems. See this third point, with learning and training feature of the network adapts itself based on the information received by it in the past experience. So that means until today, what is the system performance? Basically, every system, every computer based system is normally going to execute instructions given to it by the programmer. So if at all a computer has to perform some actions, the instructions has to be compulsorily stored by a human being or engineer into the computer. It is totally based on the instructions which have been given explicitly by the engineer into the computer. It is normally going to act accordingly. So if at all you want to take some work from the computer, you have to give instruction from outside into the computer so that it performs according to the instructions given by the user or programmer. That is what the system we have. Now, in the case of AI system, what is going to happen? AI is also a computer system, but in that computer system, you need not give instructions every time for a computer to behave. It writes its own instructions based on the past experiences, and it starts executing those instructions by itself. This is what the learning and training by itself. The system is going to learn, relearn, train by itself, and based on them, it is going to write its own instructions. And based on those instructions, it is the CPU in that particular microprocessor-based system or embedded system, such as Robo, is normally going to execute those instructions. So based on the execution, is normally going to act accordingly. So this is what the second part of a Robo movie. Rajinikanth's second part movie, Robo movie, is what that robo is doing. That robo is simply writing its own instructions, and it is simply executing those instructions with the knowledge that it has got already. So every time it is learning and writing its own instructions, and based on those instructions, it is start simply acting. That is what called, you know, something like self-learning system. That means the AI system should write its own instructions by its experiences. That means instead of user giving instructions to the computer system, the computer itself is going to write its own instructions and behaves accordingly. That is what called learning by itself. So this is an important feature for the AI systems. Now you talk about any system, so such as telephone conversation system, telecommunication system, you talk about medical field, you talk about the mechanical engineering field, you talk about chemical engineering field. So you name any field. So that means this particular AI should compulsorily fit into that. Thereby, instead of human being, the machine should simply do the activity. That is what called AI in general. So that is what AI systems we normally going to think of. Then artificial networks feature of goal seeking. This is another feature which is very difficult to incorporate in the computer-based systems. So every human being, we are all working with objectives. Say today's world present, immediately presently, the objective of every individual is that one should not get affected with the COVID. It is the objective. So feature of goals with that objective, we are simply working out by taking all the precautions. And we should not become source of that, and we should not get affected by anybody else around us. This is the main objective of the living today at present. So now today, earning money, okay, doing that, doing this, going into prosperity, okay, is not the major aspect. The major aspect is to get survive with COVID. Now, here, every individual is now has got a feature of goal seeking. What is the goal? Until the pandemic goes wiped off from the entire world, so we should be careful with the COVID. That is what the entire thing nowadays which is prevailing around us. So this is what the goal seeking feature. By seeing the circumstances, problems, we are learning by ourselves. We are not being trained by anybody else coming to our house, giving a huge training, and after training we have been after training we are not being exposed to act according to training. We are just learning by ourselves, okay, and we are keeping goals ourselves, and individually we are being responsible for ourselves, and we are responsible for other citizens around us. This is what goal seeking methods we are developing in ourselves. So same kind of a feature need to be incorporated, called future goal seeking method, where performance to achieve the goal is measured. So every AI system should keep the goal seeking feature, and because of this feature, the performance to achieve that goal is always going to get measured, used to self-organize the system. Now, and also one more method is that all these goal seeking methods should compulsorily, every time, it has to organize itself. It has to organize itself, and it has to renovate itself. It has to recorrect itself, and it has to become always keep on good, smart, and become good in the life. That is what called organizing the system by itself. So every individual also should get organized every day, every time, every second by himself towards moving towards goodness. That is what called the basic thing of self-organizing. The day when you fail, okay, that means you are not really self-organizing yourself. That is what the basic feature which every human being need to have in general. So similar kind of thing is supposed to be there with the machine as well. So this is also one of the feature we have to incorporate in the artificial intelligence using the artificial neural networks concept. So these methods are really very, very important methods. Right. So the next is, so every neuron is normally designed to perform some computational elements, so which is going to be different with other things. Okay, so that we can able to share the knowledge of one neuron with another neuron if at all is not available with the existing neuron. So like that we normally use the communication between one neuron to another neuron in the artificial neural networks for us. So that is what the process which is going to happen in the human brain. So in the human brain, we are going to have trillions of neurons. In one neuron, let us suppose there is an information available, but in order to think or give a solution to this, some other neurons may require the information of this neuron. In that case, internally, human brain is normally going to communicate with other neuron. And the neuron which is required to compute this knowledge is being used and it is being computed. So like this, it is a very complex, many to many kind of a topology implemented in the human brain. So similar kind of many to many topologies can be implemented, but we cannot really go random. Human brain is totally, hypothetical, imaginary. We really cannot predict exact model of human brain. Nobody has predicted until today. So the doctors, the neurologists reached the human brain until today only up to 40% of operating the human brain. Next 60% is still unknown to the doctors in the world. So it is that much complicated. Human brain is the most complex among all the systems in the world. So anyway, that is what the human brain, basic certain things we are simply discussing about the features of the biological neurons of the human brain. And we are trying to design an artificial network using the fuzzy logic. So that's why we normally going to have this. Now, this is what going to be the basic model known as the back propagation algorithm model. Using this model, we can just normally design a fuzzy logic system based on the neural networks. So this is a neural network which we can think of, which is more close to the biological neural network of a human brain. Biological human network of a human brain. Now, what this network is actually doing, it is normally going to have many inputs. And these many inputs are simply being implemented by the biological neural network kind of a system. And it is going to give us the final results. And these results, are simply being passed through some functionalities, which is normally going to give us the value. That means for several combinations of the inputs, we get several combinations of the outputs. Okay, that means this is being followed by another function. And this function is normally going to develop a value. And this value, whatever we get, will be simply assigned to the membership function. So this is how we normally going to implement the concept of artificial neural networks in the fuzzy logic to assign the membership values. So now let us imagine that there is a algorithm called backpropagation algorithm. In that we are going to have the series of we are going to have many nodes or series of nodes or multiple nodes at the input side, at the intermediate side, at the output side. So the number of nodes known as n suffix I be the number of nodes in the input layer, and you're going to have one more layer called as hidden layer. You cannot see hidden layer from the input port and output port because it is their intermediate. It is their intermediate. You cannot see the output. The people who are seeing from this side, they see only output nodes. The people who are seeing this one from this side, they see only the input nodes, but they cannot see what is there inside. Therefore, these nodes are known as the hidden nodes. So therefore, these layers is going to be known as this entire congregation of these nodes is known as a layer for us. So this layer, I can call it as a hidden layer because it is hidden from the outside world. Therefore, it is called hidden layer. So here, what happens now? We normally apply the inputs from the input layer. We take outputs from the output layer. And we normally use the hidden layer to communicate the signals from input to the output layers by using the network concepts. So in this, the connectivity, we normally implement some functionalities here. These functionalities, normally using this, we normally provide the mapping between one element to the other element using this. That means it provides the functionality of mapping. WJI, WKI are providing the mapping functions. It's going to map one element to the other element, and it helps in processing such information to the output nodes. And we can implement this by using two methods that is called a forward pass method. Okay, the one is going to be forward pass method. So in the forward pass method, we're going to have next one is going to be backward pass method. In forward pass method, we're going to have two methods between I and J and between. Now there are three layers. So three layers can be interfaced at two levels. Okay, so that means since we have three layers normally interfaced at two levels. One level is going to be input to the hidden layer. Next interface is going to be one interface is going to be input layer to the hidden layer interface. Another interface is going to be hidden layer to the output layer. So these two layers have been interfaced here. These two layers are going to get interfaced and it is normally going to get processed. So between I and J, we can take up a function like net J. That means it is simply connecting one type of network to another type of network. So these neurons are normally going to do some computations. These neurons are going to do some other computations. So that means this is one type of network. This is going to be another type of network, but both are being communicated just like in a computer network. In internet-based communication systems, we usually connect different types of computers in the network. So that means different types of laptops are connected, different types of operating systems are connected, different types of hardware are connected, right? So different types of, hardware systems, okay, terminologies, technologies have been interconnected. But still we are getting the work done from the internet. So internet is nothing but network of networks. So different types of networks are interconnected in the case of the internet working. So similar kind of a network we can think of, it is internet is going to be a many-to-many topology we already know. So that means here also similar kind of thing, such a complex system is going to be there. You can make this, keep on make this more or more or more complex. It is going to be an ongoing process of research. It will be going on forever and ever. It never stops. Okay. So now let us look into this layer, simple thing. We have to normally going to map the one neuron to the other neuron using this method. And we normally going to multiply this with a functionality. Okay, with a functionality. And this functionality is going to implement some method called as something like sigmoid function method. And using this method, we normally going to find out the element. So that means we normally going to get the value which is normally going to be given to this node J based on this particular functionalities and all. So like this, we normally perform get several parameters from this network for its working. Similarly, between I and J, we use the similar kind of a method to process this. So from these values, whatever obtained here, we can just find out the error which is there in the signals. By error signal is equal to sigma of EP. So EP we can write as equal to half sigma of TK minus theta K. And TK be the target and target at the kth node. So we evaluate the mean square errors like this using this formula. So like this we can just get the several parameters on this. So this is how we normally going to map using the map the values to the membership, map the values to the membership function of the fuzzy sets. So this is what regarding the third unit part. So we have done with unit number 3 now. So we have completed up to four units. In the next class, we'll deal with the unit number 5. So unit number 5 deals with two important concepts. One concept is going to be the associative memories concept. Another concept we have in unit number 5 is going to be called as fuzzy logic control systems. So now already we know basically a control system, what a control system is. Usually control system comes in two types of configurations. One is going to be called as closed loop control system. Another one is going to be the open loop control system. In the open loop control system, the output of one system is simply connected to the input of another system into another system, where the knowledge of the previous data is not known to the output side. Therefore, the controlling, we really cannot control the output values, output signals based on the previous history of the signals processed by the control system in the case of the open loop control system. So that is why, in order to increase the controlling activity, we normally apply the feedback to the system called as a feedback control system. In the feedback control system, we normally going to have the elements such as what? Now we can think of our simple feedback control system in amplifiers. In amplifier, what the control system we normally going to have, what the feedback system we normally going to have? External input signal is connected. So just imagine a feedback amplifier system. Now, when you imagine a feedback amplifier system, what are the things we are going to have? We apply the external input to the mixer circuit, and output of mixer is going to have two input signals and one output signal. And this mixer output is connected to the amplifier circuit. Output of amplifier is connected to the sample network, and output of sample is given, one output is given to the output circuit, another output is given to the feedback circuit. And feedback circuit means what? It takes portion of the output signal and gives it back to the mixer circuit, and mixer circuit is going to generate the error signal. This error signal is further processed and is been given to the amplifier circuit. So this is what the simple control, simple feedback system we have used. So simple feedback system, we simply apply it to the control system now. So instead of amplifier circuit, we normally going to have the plant utilized, used over there. So instead of the feedback system, we normally going to have the sensors, and output of sensors is normally given it as a input to the mixer circuit, and mixer circuit is going to produce error signal. After this error signal is normally given to the another further signal processing elements, and then this is given to the plant as a control signal. So therefore, the operations of plant are being controlled based on the feedback signals. That means the system becomes more controllable system because of the feedback. So similar kind of a system, once again, we are normally going to use in the fuzzy control system. In the fuzzy control system also, we normally going to use the mixer elements, sampling elements. We normally going to have the processing elements between mixer and sampler, and we're going to have the feedback element. Similar kind of things, once again, we use, but most of the time, the computation is been done by using the fuzzy logic. So that is what the difference. The next important concept is going to be associative memories, also very important concept. And these two concepts we have to discuss in the unit number 5. So from tomorrow onwards, we are not going to post the classes, because there are some holidays declared by the management of the college. So in the meanwhile, what I'm going to do is, since we have completed 4 units until today, I'm going to give you the assignments of unit number 1 to unit number 4. So please try to complete those assignments, and I will share the notes for those assignments to do also. So thank you very much for the today's session.